Greet you, YouTubers. Here is the guy with a Swiss accent, with a new episode around sensors and microcontrollers. Over the last few months, a lot of new ESP32 boards appeared on our usual marketplaces. It is time for a closer look, that you can save your money and buy the board you really need. Here I have most of the current Made in Asia boards, and I will give you an overview about their features and functions. Number of pins available for the user, ESP32 module and the ESP32 chip revision used for the board. Is the board breadboard friendly? Does it have special features like OLED or a LiPo battery charging circuit? Does it have a flash button and a USB connector? I will also measure the current for the different states: idle, Bluetooth active, Wi-Fi active in station and access point, and in both modes, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth active, and finally deep sleep. I will also measure the current during charging of the boards with a battery. And I will comment positive and negative features and experiences with these boards. There are many rumors about cloned boards and originals. I will not join this discussion. I will just test what's on my table. And you find a link in the description about my sources. Let's start with the biggest board, the WiMOS board with a 18650 LiPo battery attached below the board. It has 40 pins, which means you get all the relevant WiRoom 32 pins at the pin headers. It contains already a revision 1 chip, but it is not breadboard friendly because of the battery. I anyway cannot imagine that you want to use such a board on your breadboard, because there you do not need a battery. It has no display but a flash and a reset button. Please be aware that the reset pin of the ESP8266 is called Enable on the ESP32 boards, and most of the boards have an EN on their sales screen for that button. The flash button is called Boot here. Their function, however, is the same as with the ESP8266. I wrote a sketch to measure the current in the different modes of the chip. You find a link in the description if you want to test your own board. It toggles through the different modes, and you can use a USB tester to measure the currents. Usually I used the boot button as a toggle switch, which is connected to GPIO0. The different currents measured are similar for all development boards with USB to serial connectors and status LEDs. In the idle state, without Wi-Fi, they consume around 60 mA. If Wi-Fi is enabled, between 140 and 155 mA. If you enable Bluetooth together with Wi-Fi, the average current is a little smaller. If we put the ESP32 to deep sleep, these boards still draw around 12 mA, which is disappointing. This has nothing to do with the ESP32 chip itself, as we will see later. As with the ESP8266, development boards are not optimized for low current consumption. All in all, the currents used by these boards are about double compared with the ESP8266. The charging current at the USB connector of this board is around 600 mA, which is okay, even if we subtract the 150 mA used by the ESP itself. The battery will be charged in a few hours. The next board is a Lolin 32 board. The form factor is very similar to the ESP8266 Lolin board. It has 38 pins and a WiRoom 32 module with a revision 1 chip. Everything okay. It has a battery connector and circuitry to charge it. There is no boost converter, the 5-volt rail is dead during battery operation. And it has no display. As all development boards, it has a serial to USB chip and a USB connector, but I miss the boot button. As we see with the current measurement sketch, it is sometimes handy to have a button on the board. Its currents are very similar to the WiMOS board from before. The next board has the name TTGO printed on one side. It only has 28 pins. And more important, GPIO0 is not available as a pin. And it also has no boot button. The labeling of the pins is confusing. Sometimes the GPIO number and sometimes other labels. I would like to see the number of the GPIO pins only. Because all ESP32 pins are multi-purpose, it is anyway not possible to print all their usages on such a small board. At least it has a chip with revision 1, and it also has a battery connector. But the charging current is only 280 mA, which is very low if we subtract the 150 mA used by the ESP32. The battery will not charge very fast with the remaining 130 mA. All in all, I do not recommend this board. The next board carries a famous name, Node MCU. It has no battery and no display, has 38 pins, and it is breadboard friendly. Breadboard friendly means one row of pins rests available to connect your wires. Unfortunately, it has only an old revision 0 chip on board. The currents are slightly higher than the currents of the former boards. Unfortunately, the labeling is very small and only on the bottom of the PCB. If used on the breadboard, you cannot see the labels of the pins. For me, this board is also not a recommendation. The next board is white and has a small display on the opposite side of the chips. It has 36 pins and no VROM module. From a technical view, this is not a big issue, but it is not FCC certified. And it has a connector for a battery. I have many assortments of connectors, but I did not find one which fitted. I even did not find a matching one. Maybe somebody can send me a link to this tiny connector. I had to solder a cable to the board. However, the charge current is only 170 mA, which does not charge the battery a lot. They deliver pin labels, which can be stuck to the pin headers. I did not try it because I did not decide if I will solder the pin headers to the board. Also here, the pins are only labeled at the bottom, but at least with the GPIO numbers. Those two metallic screws are placed too close to the antenna. I removed them and put a small amount of superglue at its place. The display is nice and can be programmed with Daniel Eichhorn's library. Be aware that you have to toggle GPIO 16 to reset the display and that the I2C pins are 4 and 15. An example file is also on my GitHub. The next board is also labeled WiMOS and it has a display but no battery connector. It only has 26 pins, which reduces the number of GPIO pins considerably. Unfortunately, they delivered this board still with a revision 0 chip. It has a boot button and a USB connector. Also here, the currents are comparable to the other boards. The OLED does not add a lot of load. And the display is connected to pins 5 and 4. Unfortunately, I did not find the proper board definition to program this device automatically. I always had to press the two buttons in the well-known sequence to get it programmed. This board is compatible to several shields called X shields. They are not compatible to the WiMOS ESP8266 shields. They are wider. What a pity. If you are interested in this concept, you can buy a whole set together. If you are interested in the shields concept, this board is okay, but not as a general purpose board. The next one is very similar like the Node MCU board, only with a revision 1 chip. The labeling is on top, but a little strange. GPIOs are labeled as GXX, and some pins are labeled with other purpose of the pins. So you always have to find out first which GPIO is connected to which pin. On my GitHub you find a small sketch to find out which pin is connected to which GPIO number. Just connect the button switch between one pin and ground. If you start the sketch and press the button, you see which pin changes its state. By the way, you must not define all GPIOs as input. Otherwise, your chip crashes because you interfere with a flash chip interface. The next board is small and has the form factor of an export. It can be used as an alternative to the WiMOS with the display from before. It has only 18 pins and is not breadboard friendly because it has these pins here. And the chip is revision 0. The next board is also quite small. It has also a VROOM module and a revision 0 chip, but 40 pins. Unfortunately, the holes are too small for pin headers. You only can solder thin wires to them. The labels are only on the bottom side, but if you solder the wires from the top, this is okay. It has no boot button, no display or battery, and the deep sleep current is, with 76 mA, very high. If you look for a compact board, I think this is a good choice. The next one is a compromise. It has the Arduino Uno form factor and the VROOM 32 module on it. The chip revision is 1. More than a year ago, I tested a similar board with an ESP8266. I did not like it at all because it was not at all Arduino Uno compatible. It had a 3.3 volt logic and the ESP8266 has much less pins than an Atmega 328P chip. So the board only had one analog pin and some of the Arduino pins were connected to the same ESP8266 pin. Libraries did not work because of this pin chaos and the 3.3 volt logic. I'm sure the board disappointed most of their buyers. WiMOS discontinued it shortly afterwards and introduced the much better WiMOS D1 Mini. This new ESP32 board has similar issues. It is 3.3 volt logic and most of the libraries will not work. This board at least has enough pins and the analog pins are also connected to analog pins of the ESP32. To make it compatible to at least some libraries, it would be necessary to define a board and to find a way to use analog pins. Because up till now, analog read is not implemented for the ESP32. All in all, I do not recommend this board unless you know exactly what you do, and your shield is 3.3 volt compatible, you do not need analog pins, and you know how to do defines to mimic Arduino pin naming. The last board is not a real board. It is just a VROOM 32 module soldered on a PCB by me. I added also pull-up resistors for GPIO 0 and enable. The PCB already comes with the two switches. It has no USB, no regulator, no display or battery. But it has two big advantages. It can be used for low power devices because it only consumes 70 microampere during deep sleep. And it is cheap. The PCB is not very good. At least it should have two additional pull-up resistors. Like that, I had to add them myself. They, for sure, add a little to the 17 microampere deep sleep current. This board could be enhanced. An HT7333 LDO regulator would be a nice feature. Maybe somebody has mercy with us and creates such a board. And he must not forget the beefy capacitor between VCC and ground of the VROM32 module. Because also with the ESP32, we have the same problem as with the ESP8266. If we do not have a proper 3.3 volt supply, it will crash. At least this one tells us what happened. After reboot, it writes that the reset reason was a brownout. During a brownout, in contrary to a blackout, there is still electricity available, but with restrictions. In order to prevent unstable behavior, the VROOM 32 resets itself if the voltage goes below 2.5 volt. Be aware that revision 0 chips do not boot anymore if a brownout was detected. By the way, I discovered a slightly better PCB with added resistors. I suggest that you buy these instead of the ones I used. To program barebone VROOM 32 modules, you can buy such a device. You just place the module here and it behaves like a normal development board. After programming, you can solder it to the PCB you want. This could be interesting if you want to use OTA or if your code is already stable and tested. Summarized, we looked at 11 ESP32 boards, which is a lot if we compare with the situation just a few months ago. The modules are quite different in shape and have different features. They range from barebone VROM modules to boards with displays, batteries and charging circuits. Unfortunately, we still find many revision zero boards in this selection. All boards consume about the same current. Only the deep sleep currents vary considerably. All development boards are not suited for low power applications. This is the strength of the barebone VROOM 32 module. Labeling is another issue. I would prefer a simple numbering using GPIO numbers on both sides of the board. Unfortunately, not many boards use this concept. Which is the best board? There is no overall best board. Some of them will sit for the rest of their life in a bin in my lab and probably never will be used. I mentioned these during the review. For my developments, I use the yellow board, which is very similar to the WeMOS board without the OLED. It has many pins and is also quite cheap. I have not decided about the ones with batteries because I have to do more testing, but this is stuff for another video. With this big selection of boards, it is definitely the time to start with the ESP32. The momentum seems to be here. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. Bye!